This is Duke University.
And, we're so excited to have Sanyin Siang. I realize that this is like an excellent, I've achieved some sort of master class in alliteration. You do realize that, right? That's why you're first. So, we didn't really plan that way. So this is Story Lab. Welcome to Story Lab. Story Lab is part of Franklin Humanities Institute, and it's one of the humanities labs that has been sort of the product of a Mellon grant, a generous Mellon grant, Humanities writ large. And it's really about reinvigorating and reinventing the humanities. And several other labs include the Haiti Lab, the Global Brazil Lab, the Audiovisualities Lab. And so we are the latest baby. We're Story Lab. And part of, really the genesis or the sort of thinking behind Story Lab, and it sounds so, we kept it intentionally plain as a title, is that stories basically permeate our lives and in all disciplines and all fields. And but it's really interesting to be a humanities professor in a university these days, because basically you're being told by both administration and by the popular press, by mainstream media, that humanities is irrelevant, or it's dying, or it's in crisis, or how can you get a job after college if you're a humanities major. But on the other hand, I teach popular culture, I teach film studies, literature, and basically my sense is everywhere I looked around, people were obsessed with stories. My students follow stories, they're part of fandoms. We're here in the home of the biggest sports rivalry ever. That there is this sense that we follow stories intensely and they're part of our cultural identity. And also we're in the golden age of serial TV right now, right? For those of you who watch sort of a lot of premium cable, and also the sort of rise of fan fiction because of the ease of publishing means that so many fans take part in stories they love. And so to that extent, I was saying, okay, everywhere I turn, there were stories being told. And so why is it that we see that as completely separate and not related to sort of the professional or academic study of storytelling? And so my colleagues, Carlos Rojas and Claire Woods and I decided to form Story Lab as a way of, in some ways, encouraging a common shared space for storytelling. And the second aspect of Story Lab that I should elaborate is, right when I started, when we started planning this thing, there's also a sense of a kind of divide between humanities. So, people who professionally study stories, and then everybody else who uses stories, but then we don't call them storytellers. Mm-hmm. But of course, Fortune 500 companies now have chief storytellers. That's a lot of what you do in branding and management. It's what you do, obviously, in social sciences like anthropology, public policy programs. I mean, it's always about a rhetoric of persuasion. We're watching sort of conflicting rhetorics of persuasation right now with the 2016 election, right? And the way in which the stories are completely incompatible, right? That everybody is hearing a completely different story and convinced that that story is the true one. And so part of what we wanted to do was not to limit it to sort of thinking about storytelling in a humanities sense, but rather open it up and say, colleagues in other fields, colleagues across professional schools, also use storytelling or think of storytelling as very much part of their research, their teaching, their mode of relating to students, but also to the world at large. And so there's a couple flyers. It's also online, but I just wanted to alert you to that this is the beginning of a series, and we're so grateful that Sanyin is the beginning of our series, but we do have a host of speakers coming in March. March 23rd is Tom Robichaud from History. March 30, Lori, who is head of Duke Media Fellows, will be bringing two of her media fellows who started Storytegic, so working journalists, to talk about, obviously, storytelling and journalism. We continue with Deborah Jensen, director of FHI, but also someone who's experimented in terms of looking at neurohumanities as a sort of stories of the brain, is what she'll be talking about. And I just wrote Robin Kirk, who is not in this, but will be online, which is April 13th, so you can add April 13th on here, Robin Kirk, who will speak about stories and human rights narratives, right? And so we're really, really excited about that. and we conclude with us, but if we find somebody more exciting, we'll just replace us. and then there are many more faculty, and so we envision that this is a series that will go on the fall. We have faculty team members, as it were, such as Mark Cruz in physics, Fritz Mayer in Sanford School, you know, other people that we would love to have, Jean Geith in Russian, that we would like to bring into the fold and to have them share their experiences of dealing with storytelling or telling stories. But today, without further ado, is Sanyin Siang. She's executive director of the Fuqua Coach K Center on Leadership and Ethics, short COLE, I guess. I didn't realize that. But I told her that I wouldn't say too much about what she does on a daily basis because I think that's part of what she's here to share with us today. But Sanyin and I are also dear friends for a multitude of reasons, but also because we're both really fascinated with also children's storytelling, right? That, you know, what, you know, when you think about how you understand or how you come to expect a story to look like from Once Upon a Time to Happily Ever After, it's very much shaped by the stories that are told to you and that you tell as a child. So one of the projects that we're going to do going forward next year is really looking at children's literature. But Sanyin is herself already cross-disciplinary. As an undergraduate at Duke, you were engineering major, right? So, but then went on to get an MBA. So, you know, she is looking at a sort of story and branding and influencing and leadership from all these different angles. So, without further ado, let's welcome Sanyin.
Thank you. Looking around the table, I see many good friends, and I feel like this is a family, it's a community, and that's why I was really excited about Story Lab, because this is a place where people from all different backgrounds, all different disciplines can come together to explore the art of storytelling, the influence of storytelling, the techniques and strategies of storytelling. So thank you so much for having me here. Now, storytelling at its core is about engagement, and so that's how I think about this next hour and a half. Is I'm not very good at doing presentations, meaning sit here and just talk endlessly. I get bored hearing myself talk. But what I'd like to do is just toss out a few points. And I know there's so many of you who are experts in storytelling here, and to be able to riff around that, all right? So let me start off by saying I cheated a little bit. It's a confession. I cheated a little bit when Eileen asked me to come up with the name of the talk. I said storytelling as influence. Well, I cheated because storytelling is ultimately about influencing. Every time we tell a story, it's not just to entertain, it's also we're trying to get a point across. We're trying to shape the way someone is thinking. So there's the ultimately that purpose to it. And that's one of the reasons why Eileen and I are starting up the children's division of Story Lab. And one of our core projects is to look at how stories can influence character development in children. You know, what are the stories that we tell? So if you look at the Cinderella story as an example, you tell that story, okay, it's a story, but on one hand, it's a story about industriousness, about kindness, but what if we also engage the child in the shaping of that story and we start using questions and asking them, all right, so who do you see yourself as in the story? It may not be Cinderella. It may be the stepmother, for example. Could the stepsister have made other choices that led to different outcomes? And through that engagement, suddenly the story takes on a much more organic, fluid, and dynamic form. So that's just a plug for one of the, be on the lookout for that story project. The second thing, you know, the second confession I have is I'm no more an expert at storytelling than you are. I mean, stories, as Eileen said, permeates every part of our lives, right? Whether we realize it or not, it's the resumes that we write. It's the music that we listen to. There's so many different mediums. That social media post in itself is a mini story, right? It's conveying something that when we post something on Facebook or LinkedIn or Twitter or Instagram, even that picture itself is conveying a story. So I bet between the time you woke up this morning and the time you got here, you've probably told about 25 stories. So I'm no more an expert at storytelling than any of you are. However, what I can do and what I hope to do is take some of the work that I'm doing at the Fuqua Coach K Center on Leadership and Ethics, the leadership aspect, and be able to infuse that into, connect that with storytelling. So leadership ultimately is about persuasion and influence. You know, it's purposeful, right? People think about it as command and control, but ultimately, that's not what it is. It's about how do you unleash that individual potential? How do you unleash that collective potential in a drive towards something? And so that's what we think about every day is in engaging with our students. How do we convey this information in a way that resonates with them? So you think about credibility, and you also think about context. Why does this information matter? And how does it matter? And you also think about trust building, which is ultimately about engagement. So leadership, those are the core underpinnings of what foundational elements of leadership. Personal leadership, which is really about credibility. Relational leadership, which is ultimately about trust building. And contextual leadership, which is about everyone being able to see the big picture so all the puzzle pieces come together. So as a start, I guess that leads to, on credibility, I guess that leads to my third confession. And I promise that'll be the last confession. I don't want to give too much away, especially since this is being filmed. When I first came to Duke in 19, so Eileen said, I run a center that bears the name of Coach K, the greatest coach in the world, in history. And when I first came to Duke in 1992, my college friends, such as Angela here, Angela is actually a Dukie who's come back and visiting this month and a half, will usually laugh when I told them what I'm doing now in running the Coach K Leadership and Ethics Center because of the Coach K part. When I first came to Duke in 1992, I thought there were three basketball coaches, Krzyzewski, Krzyzewski, and Coach K. Took me a year to realize they were all the same person. So when you think about that, you will think, I'm the last person in the world who will be qualified for this job, right? But what I did was I reframed it. And I said, that's a part of my story, but here's how that would matter to the Coach K Leadership and Ethics Center. Coach K sees himself as a teacher of leadership. And coaching in basketball is a platform in which he exercises that identity. So I can actually talk to the non-converted. Imagine all the people who are not who are not into basketball or sports. But I fell in love with Coach K. I can't name a single stat, you know. But I fell in love with Coach K and his work because of what he stands for, how he is an ultimate people developer, and how he just the way he can build trust and systems and context, the way he leads. So I can help. In a way, I'm a great ambassador for that because of my story, right? That I didn't come from it from a sports angle, I came out from it from a leadership angle. And that leads to one thing about credibility. Every time you're telling a story, you have to think about your credibility and how, in leading, it's about how do you up your credibility capital, so to speak. And so in that story, it was about reframing. How are you going to frame the elements of your story to be able to shape people's perceptions, to get them to connect with what you're ultimately trying to get them to do. So that's credibility. The next thing is context. So when we think about context, we're in a very data-laden world. But what we're missing is a way of connecting that data together, a way of filtering that data. Data in the absence of context is meaningless. That's what stories do, right? Stories put that information in a way that's emotionally resonant. And so one story that I think is a perfect illustration of context comes from the book Leading Up. In the book, there's a story about Charles Schwab, the online trading company. Now, before it became online, it was, you know, people call co-op traders. And in the early 1990s, it realized, David Poltruck, who was one of its leaders, realized they need to shift the entire company to also do online trading. Now, that's not as easy as it might sound. To do that, they actually have to take a hit in one of their, it's a public company, they have to take a hit in one of their quarters that would just be terrible. And it involved maybe letting go of people and involved reshifting the way people think about their roles, their habits, and how they worked, and worked individually as well as worked together. So what he did was he told a story. Actually, he did more than that. He brought people with him on a story. So he took all the shareholders, major shareholders, and he took them to the Golden Gate Bridge. And he said, look, look at this bridge. It was built in during the Great Depression, during a time when finances were hard, when morale was down, and yet it was built. Look at it. It survived, and it's magnificent. And then what he did was he walked all 200 of the people who were with him there that day across that 2-mile bridge so they could feel the impact, right? And they could feel what he was trying to do. That, to me, is how storytellers use stories in business. Is it's ultimately about influencing, right? Then the third aspect I talked about in leadership is about trust, relational leadership. Ultimately, it's about how you're connecting with with others and how you're engaging with others. I was really excited to hear that Carlos is that Story Lab here actually has a fan fiction division, because fan fiction is actually taking, just as David Poltruck had done, taking the audience from being just the audience, but actually making them co-authors, co-shapers, and active participants in the story. And that's where we see in storytelling in business going now. So the days, think about 10 years ago, the PR division in most companies was about the perfect press release. But the press release is a story, right? Perfect press release out there. Nowadays, the press release is dead, because people, the customers as well as your employees, have this expectation of immediacy of response. They crave authenticity, so not that perfection, authenticity. And they also crave transparency, and that you know who they are. So how do, where do most PR departments work in now? It's not on press release, it's actually on social media. It's that engagement, right? Because social media allows for the engagement of your audience directly in co-shaping your narrative. When I think about engagement, I also think about the Olympics. You know, it's not only how you tell your story, but who you bring along with you to tell your story. So what I mean by that is you look at the Olympics and you look at Procter & Gamble. Procter & Gamble had these beautiful, Olympics is ultimately, it can attract across both genders because it's about stories, right? The stories of the athletes, the backstories, the stories of triumph over obstacles and challenges. And Procter & Gamble, which a huge part of its market is moms, did something brilliant. It had the an entire commercial connected with the Olympics where it's about the athletes when they're little with their moms and the mom's role in the outcome, which is the athletes, the Olympians. And so it was brilliant how who brought Procter & Gamble brought with them to co-shape that story. It was the U.S. It was the Olympics. And so think also about not only about the elements of your story, but also who you engage with. And then also, you may not be the first person to tell your story. It might be someone else instead. You know, think about the influence, right? So some strategies I use, I love being a network weaver. I love being a connector. And so a lot of times I am positioning people to be able to connect with other people so they can find value in each other. And ultimately, so if McCall here, for example, is working with me on a project that's about reclaiming the prince's identity as leader, problem solver, and team player. So if McCall were to try to approach a CEO and just do an email and tell your story, that may not be as effective. But if I know that CEO, you can say, hey, Sanyin, I'm trying to do this. Can you be my co-conspirator in this? Me telling her story because of my credibility with that CEO may actually lead to a more effective outcome that you're trying to achieve, right? So it may not be you telling your story. It's who do you have telling your story. And when you think in business nowadays, when people are on social media talking about a brand, that's actually others telling your story. But you just have to find the influencers and the catalysts. And then the last point I want to leave you with before we open up for riffing and engagement is go beyond the traditional confines of storytelling. Right? So you think about storytelling as verbal or written. What I love about Story Lab is this is an exploration of the myriad of formats that we have for telling stories, whether it's digital, it's social media, comic books. I know Eileen just had an author here who wrote his entire dissertation as a comic book. And this really comes to light in this past Saturday when I went to see The Lion King. Now, have you all seen The Lion King musical? If you haven't, you must. And actually, we have one of the cast members here. And Michael Holick was showing me around the backstage of The Lion King. And one of the things we talked about was what's part of the genius of The Lion King. And I remember seeing it for the first time this Saturday. And that the story, oh my goodness. One, you think about the traditional stage as where the story is, and we're in the audience, right? But when you start, at one point, the characters are coming up along the aisles, and suddenly you feel the space becomes much larger, and you're enveloped in the story. That's genius. Julie Taymor broke the confines of space, right? Just as through social media, we're breaking the confines of how are people engaging and participating. The other thing that was just awesome to me was you have the actors who are playing out different characters. They also have, those actors are also connected to these puppets that they're operating. So suddenly you have what Michael shared is a double event, and the audience are seeing that story, what that character is saying enforced in two different ways. And then for that one character, you think, oh, it's characters are played by people. Or that's why you go to see theater on the stage. And if you want to go see puppets, you go see a puppet show. And if you want to go, you know, see like non-puppets, basically, I'm thinking of the
puppets.
Just shadow puppets. Or what's that scene where Pumbaa and Nala were going on a chase?
Yes. There's rod puppets.
Rod puppets.
Bunraku puppetry from Japan. There's
that's right.
Julie Taymor was a expert in different forms of cultural theater, traveled mm-hmm. the world, and she kind of put all of this into the show, which sounds like it would be a recipe for disaster, but it seems to work seamlessly.
But she broke the mold, right? So she did two things there. One is she took, like, one character can be expressed in so many different forms, shadow puppets, rod puppets, character puppet, like the operating puppets. And she drew from so many different sources to be able to find the things that connect with the story. And we're seeing that all the time, drawing from different sources. You look at what's happening on TV, you know, Supergirl, I'm a huge fan of TV shows. We talk a lot about TV. Supergirl is using the superhero context to be able to share perspectives, ask questions about, what is it, career, women and careers, right? Supergirl's grappling with the relationship between Supergirl and her mom, Supergirl and her sister, Supergirl and her boss. I mean, it's just a way of drawing from the superhero context, culture, to be able to tell that story very powerfully. And so with that, I like to just open it up for either questions or so many of you are experts here. I mean, John, you're a graphic designer and you're an expert in storytelling when it comes to the visual through design, right? Through how people engage with their surroundings. And we've got the Duke Communications and Development team over here. I mean, you guys live stories every day of your life. So please jump in and share perspectives and in terms of how you use your stories to build credibility, to connect with the audience, to build trust. And we've also have marvelous students here, like McCall, and so you see that every day. I mean, you're writing your resume in class, the papers, and Mimi Kelly, whom I just met, I just learned has 34 years in the film production business, including a set of documentaries that you did with CBS. So I'm, oh, and Lori Bly with the media fellows, I mean, journalists are telling stories. And you'll hear one of her fellows, Amy Lewin, speak on March 30th. I love making plugs for people, so this is March 30th. But you're an expert when it comes to storytelling to influence public opinion, you know. And along that, you think about TV and film. Just before this, I was having a conversation with Lily Hayes Kaufman. She's a Duke grad who now is working on a set of TV shows, making pitches on TV shows. She's fantastic. And we're talking about, she wanted to, one of her shows is about how getting people to think about why is it that the main character in a lot of, the main female character in a lot of TV shows is this perfect picture, picture perfect looking person. You know, why can it be someone who's plus size? Why can it be someone, you know, just through what we see, we be, right? And so the conversation there was, I wonder how much 24, the show 24, which is a huge hit, when they have the president is an African American, but it was never explicit. It was, we just saw it, and that acculturated us to the notion of a African American president. I wonder how much that show actually had an influence for us to actually have the first African American president, right? What we see, the stories that we see, are constantly shaping what we believe in and what can be possible. And so maybe there should be a TV show for our first female president. Hillary is speaking at Hillside. Oh, it was canceled?
Yes.
Oh, no.
Yikes. It tells you something about what we're
betrayed
to and not.
Okay. Thank you.
So much for opening up the conversation, and true to Sun's form, she plugged like half the room. Thank you. This is one of the most, she's one of the most generous people I know. She's always connecting. She actually just connected me to Mike. So really grateful that she is part of Story Lab. So, but I thought that, I'm sure people have lots of thoughts or comments or questions.
One default assumption would be that you're talking about stories of success in order to engender success, right? Mm. And you're also talking about the success of the stories, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you're talking about telling stories successfully about successful ventures, going to get rich, what have you, in order to encourage further success. And I was wondering if you could say, I mean, but then you also mentioned authenticity, and authenticity implies failure, right?
Yeah. Huge.
Yeah.
So, just one
example, right? I mean, Julie Taymor, right?
Mm.
Lion King. I haven't seen it yet. It sounds.
You should.
It sounds great.
It's
not
great.
Successful. On the other hand, Julie Taymor is
Spider-Man.
Notorious for something that was less successful.
And yeah.
I was wondering if you could talk about a couple of things. And I mean, behind you, we have an expert on failure.
Oh, really? Wait, that doesn't sound too good.
No.
She actually works on failure.
Yeah. Oh, really? I'm Sanyin.
Hi, I'm Erin.
Erin, let's talk afterwards.
If you could talk a little bit about both the what happened. The failure of a story, right?
Yeah.
If a story that doesn't work the way you want it to, or a story about failure, right? How that might work, or even a story that might somehow be intended to produce failure, right?
Okay, I love that. We believe that everybody, if you don't have a failure in your life that you can talk about, you haven't tried hard enough. You know, or you haven't stretched hard enough. Failure is actually, I think if we look back at all, failure and success are not polar opposites. they're actually like a horseshoe. They're very close to one another. What I mean by that is, if you look back at all the people who, you know, failure makes us feel incredibly uncomfortable. It makes us feel incredibly vulnerable. But that strategic vulnerability is how you frame that failure in such a way that can engender success. What I mean by that is, if you look back in your life at all your successes, I bet at one point there's a hardship or something that went awry that made you rethink how you were doing things. And it's about that learning experience from that that actually ultimately led to the success. So I'll give you one great example of someone who repositioned failure as a learning experience. Thomas Edison. Thomas Edison said, someone had said, hey, how does it feel to fail 10,000 times at inventing the light bulb? 10,000 times, 10,000 tries, didn't work. Failures, right? He's like, what do you mean? I didn't fail 10,000 times. I just found out 10,000 ways not to do it. How not to do it. That's a great way connecting failure to ultimately to success. But failure is not a destination. It is part of the process, right? The real failure is when you make that failure a destination and you just stop there, you let it engulf you. So I think about Julie Taymor, actually David Menzel, who was the CEO of Marvel. He's the one who brought Iron Man to life, is a dookie. Right? And he could tell you failure story after failure story. And when I met David 3 or 4 years ago, no, 4 or 5, gosh, time just flies when you have kids. He was so excited because he said, I'm going to be bringing Spider-Man to Broadway, and I've got Bono, yeah. I'm also musically, culturally illiterate, long to being sports illiterate. That's my failure right there, right? I'm being strategically vulnerable right now, too. And he's like, Bono and Julie Taymor, and they're going to be a part of this, and isn't it cool? It's going to be the best Broadway show in the world, right? And Julie Taymor had just come off the success of The Lion King, and everyone was excited, and the show, you know, after a very short time, just ended its run. And there was even, I remember turning on TV and there was a Law and Order criminal intent episode that was, even though these are not based on actual life events, the story was very similar to a genius director, producer, and a failed Broadway flop. I would be curious to see where Julie Taymor goes. Is she going to let that define her? And just said, Lion King was a one-time, was a hit, but now I'm a failure? Or is she going to take that and say, here's what I learned from it, here's what I learned from it, here are what my constraints are. With Lion King, she broke the boundaries of what's possible. And with Spider-Man, she was trying to do that, but maybe she went too far, right? Here's the constraints, and what I can learn from that is, here's for my next thing. Now, it's going to be a harder path probably for her to get funding for her next thing, but I'm very curious to see where that goes if she doesn't let failure be a destination. Oh, by the way, when we're talking modalities, I remember what I wanted to say at that point. Different modalities in telling the story. Hamilton, it's a mishmash of things that you think wouldn't work, but actually work. Now, confession, I have not seen Hamilton. I've heard a lot of people talk about it. I've seen little bits and pieces, but what I've seen is genius in that it uses different elements that are very relevant to our culture today to be able to connect audiences across so many different domains, and that's why it's such a great success today, right? So, but failure, back to you, Carlos, back to what you were saying, I think failure has to be a part of the story.
It's an exercise. It's practice. When we pretend we're other characters, or we're in different circumstances, and that's why tragedy is, you know, the story of failure is just as important as the hero's journey and the story of success. Mm-hmm. And as an audience, if we subscribe to one or the other too much, we can get into dangerous waters. If we subscribe to the hero's journey too much, then we can think that, well, everything's going to work out for us. We're always going to succeed. Even in the face of obstacles, we'll always succeed. And if we subscribe too much to the tragic story, you can get very down in the mouth and feel like you know, you're never going to succeed, when the truth lies somewhere in the middle. I had a teacher once who said that we will all have a sink or swim moment. And when you're young, I remember, you know, we all of us students thought, well, of course, I'm gonna swim. You know, there's no way, you know. But until you do the hard work of becoming a well-adjusted person and preparing yourself for that event, it's not a foregone conclusion that you're gonna swim. As a matter of fact, most people probably would say that they sink. And as you, you know, being an expert in failure, you know that.
That sounds horrible.
We have to be really honest. I'll speak next.
We'll reframe you. We'll have to reframe you as
a. Rebrand me.
Okay, we'll rebrand you.
There are some failures that you might not come back from, that you might not be able to learn from, that will define you, that will break you. But only if you let it. And once again, that's where it's important for the Lion King in particular. This is a story that kind of encapsulates both. It's tragic. For those of you that don't know, the father figure dies at the end of Act One. So there's a tremendous tragedy there, a tremendous sense of loss. And it's a situation where we could find ourselves as the protagonist and the audience identifying with him as that's all is lost. But then the second act is about the hero's journey and him confronting that challenge and his failures in dealing with that challenge initially. As a young boy, he runs away and he runs from it. And he winds up confronting his failure and he does swim. So I think, you know, in terms of the success and failure, framing that in terms of storytelling, at least in terms of theater, it is an exploration of failure. It has to be, because that's the only way as we as a species evolve, is from being challenged, failing in the face of that challenge, and theater allows us to do that without the risk, you know, that we can say, okay, so if Romeo and Juliet, they die at the end, whoa, I don't want to die at the end. So what can I learn from their journey and apply it towards my own life?
And I think that's something that Eileen talked about earlier, why the humanities are so important, right? Because the humanities enable us. As a science major, engineering major, I'm all about STEM, but not at the expense of the arts and humanities, because the humanities enable us to play out those scenarios, just as Michael had talked about, in our heads and place ourselves in the story in such a way that lead to deeper self-discovery. I mean, self-awareness is huge in the leadership field, and self-awareness comes from engagement with others. I'm learning so much about myself just through this conversation with you guys. It's also about taking risks and failing, right? And in the entrepreneurial on business, you think about many of our students want to build up startups. They want to be entrepreneurial. Well, it's a hard journey that is full of failures after failures. We hear about the success stories like Facebook or Pinterest, or I'm like, it's a tough time right now in entrepreneurship, right? But there's so, for every story here, there's probably thousands that have failed, right? So entrepreneurship, I mean, that in itself is the entire story of how the field of entrepreneurship is unfolding, is rife with failures. I'm curious to hear from you, so tell us a little bit more.
Well, you guys said a lot, but to me, it's really important to talk about failures that are just straight up failures, mm-hmm. and that we are so predisposed. I feel like the way that failure stories are framed right now, it's very much American Dream 2.0. So you fail fast, you fail quick in order to get to that success. Mm-hmm. And oftentimes the people who are able to fail fast, fail quick, fail forward, fail up, are those that have enough of a support system socially, financially, so that there's this luxury, that failure is a luxury, that risk is a luxury.
Oh,
and so the way I try to frame it is a couple of ways. First, that the differential consequences of failure are foundational to American injustice. And so how do we create safety nets and safe places to fail so that everyone has the right Mm-hmm. Everyone has the right to be an entrepreneur. Mm-hmm. Everyone has the right to be creative, to be in theater. My sister's a theater director, so everyone has the right to have these places to think and explore and grow.
You know, I love what you're saying about the safe places, because one of the things we see as critical to leadership is that leaders have to create safe places for their people to test out ideas, to experiment, and it might actually fail and not lead to anything else, right? And they won't be fired for it, because it's about the learning that it's that, okay, but the learning is what moves it forward. And this idea, it's just really interesting what you're just saying about failure, democratizing failure, is that what it is? Democratizing failure. So in today's age, when everything we do is captured and seen, how much latitude do we have to fail? You know, all throughout, it's not only the people who are coming up now, our students, but you think about our leaders in public offices, and there's not a lot of latitude because everything is so open. You know?
So I just want to say, Aaron Parrish, doctoral student, did wonderful work. So get her up later.
Thanks, guys.
Other thoughts?
Other questions? Or, yeah, please.
James.
I think that's right. I'm James. I'm first in a graduate of Fuqua. I always thought tragedy was really helpful, and it was about failure. And it was a lot of post-enlightenment stuff was about breaking through and transcending, but it was really, you know, these stories about failure and models that we didn't have to experience it ourselves. We could read this model. And what you just said is really interesting. I've been in the entrepreneurial space for a while, and the fetishization of failure has been really interesting. I was really grateful that so much of my business school application involved when have you failed and how did you handle it, because I had a lot of good stories. And a lot of other sort of tracks in life into the upper middle class, you cannot show any weakness.
Mm-hmm.
But at applying to business school, it's like, when have you failed? I was like, well, this is refreshing. But then a couple years in, it becomes this sort of, people become a little bit reckless, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'm gonna really fail fast. You know, slow down, let's not like waste our resources just because, you know, the lean startup says fail fast. So that's a really interesting, I haven't heard it said that way, but it really makes sense from my experience recently that it kind of loses its optimal learning influence if you're just doing it so you can say you failed.
But I think that connects back to something we started off with, which is purpose, right? Every story has a purpose. Every journey, if you're intentional about it, you can, it's not failing for the sake of failure, but it's
right.
Towards something.
The whole idea of failure, the whole idea is there's an implication of risk.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing ventured, nothing gained. And I think if we were able to help people who, you know, to democratize failure, it would be to change their perspectives and begin to frame everything in real and imagined fears. Because you're going to be eaten by a shark when you're in the ocean in a shark-infested waters is a real fear, and you should be afraid. It's good. You should be afraid of that. But failure in a business venture or anything else that's framed by our constructs of society, if you whittle it down, and I know this might sound kind of like rah-rah, as long as you're still kicking, as long as you're still standing on this earth, you have resources and the failure, while it can be an intense hit, you still, it's all about, if for each individual, finding the perspective to say, okay, I'm down, but I'm not out, and here's how I rise up.
So let's take this from this sort of more philosophical
mm-hmm.
conversation on failure to actually driving it deep. Now, I know that you talk about support system, right? And part of that support system is family. And I think, you know, one of the reasons why Eileen and I are so passionate about looking at kids is because science shows us that our brains are wired by age 8. And so why are we introducing these concepts in at college or business school? It's almost far too late. So with children, I know there are several moms in the room. And as a mom myself, I'm curious to learn how you guys, like Angela's a mom, I know JC and Pella and Mimi, and I know there's others here whom I don't know, but who have children, how you guys foster that sense of, use stories to foster that sense of, that judgment call of when I can take this risk and when this risk might actually make me drown, to talk about the water reference.
And just to jump in, I love what everyone has said about failure, and I really think Erin just said something really important about, you know, that and I think the recklessness of, you know, says is also entitlement, right? I mean, mm-hmm. saying that I can fail and nobody's going to judge, it's the thing that failed and not I that failed, right? Mm-hmm. But I think that for a lot of people, and I think anybody who's been a woman in a corporate environment, a person of color, in any environment in the U.S., I mean, you know that you're always judged, and also the worst thing is you're not just judged as a failure for your failing, so it's not just a thing that failed, it's you that failed, but your race has failed, right? So my students in my ethnic studies class constantly talk about how, and they were joking about when Fresh Off the Boat first premiered, and there are friends of mine who work on that show, and they were saying the great dread was not that the show would, it was rep sweats, representation sweats, meaning like if you failed and all Asian Americans look bad, you know, and all Asian American actors are going to be judged by this failure. And so that's, I think, absolutely what is not democratized in our society. And the question is, what are the solutions around it? Mm. And one of the things we thought is you begin with storytelling, you begin with offering possibilities at a very young age, you know, that you're not always a sidekick, you know, or you're not always the perfect student, you're not always the rebel, and so that you have these imaginative ways of exploring, you know, different identities even at a young age. But no, absolutely, I think that's a great point. I thought that was, your points together were so wonderful, because I do think that when we see a kind of white collar recklessness sometimes, it is from this idea that it's okay, we'll just keep going, we'll get more capital, we'll get more credibility, we can keep going.
There's not a sense of accountability or responsibility.
Right. Whereas, you know, for other people might, you know, that sometimes in other circumstances that might not be true. So back to the Fresh Off the Boat example. So All American Girl with Margaret Cho was terrible. It lasted one season. It failed there were 20 years with no network TV show with Asian American families, right? Wow. And I think that she was always, you know, so in some ways people blamed her. Like, your show failed, and therefore Asian American actors didn't get another network show for 20 years. Whereas Fresh Off the Boat is doing well, you have criticism of it, it's doing well, and so suddenly there are other shows, right, that have Asian American casts. So that's kind of, that. I feel like that is something that gets tangled into storytelling, because it's not individual story, it's community story, right?
It's so who, and
it's
also...
the group story.
Well, I liked your point about just talking about failure. Failure where you just failed, that's it. I mean, we don't talk about that in general.
The narratives that you were selling were not failure. It was growth and change over time.
Right.
So it's being able to see that's a measurable, deliverable impact. Right? And so I think when we tell failure stories like that, that are joyous and purposeful and do end with the destination is success, then we remove ourselves from the empathetic capacity that comes from failures that are just failures, and failures that have caused pain. And I think we can put that into a leadership perspective as well, of like how do, and I think about Brené Brown and the gift of vulnerability and this idea that our story is just data with soul, that we can look at data, we can look at input, and we can tell stories that maybe don't turn out well, but give us this empathetic leadership to be able to actually design better policy, better projects, better businesses.
Yeah, I think empathy is actually huge in leadership. I mean, because when you're asking people to innovate or to change, most of the time, we just did this year is exploring building a culture, at our center we're exploring this theme of building a culture of innovation, the human factors. What we mean by that is you may have the most brilliant idea and you know this is a direction the company has to go towards, but why is it that when they're at the point of implementation, it all falls apart. It's because the leaders, the higher up you go in an organization, the harder it is for you to empathize with those along the front line. So what we did there was we took that idea of all the discomfort that comes with change, right? And at our summit, we called upon three people who are actually in transition mode, so it come from success, but now their next chapter is a big question mark, and one of those is Shane Battier. You know, Shane, huge success, but that discomfort where you have to, the next chapter, you have to change your habits, you have a, you know, how do you get people to empathize with that? I mean, that's one of his biggest challenges, right?
So I have this story, which is a failure, unfortunately. That I think is single-handedly the best essay I've read on teaching. And it's by Adrienne Wadewitz, who some of you may know. She was a young colleague in English, and she got her, and she was a postdoc at Indiana University. But she talks about her experience learning rock climbing, and that she was so clumsy, but she loved it. She loved it with a passion. And she took to it. But then she realized that she would be like in a 12-week class, and somebody would come in, you know, on week 12, and they're week one, and they're doing things that she can't do. And she suddenly empathized because she said, basically, anybody who's on the success track, including academics who've gone through a PhD, you always select for things you're good at, right? You always end up in classes you're good at, you end up in fields you're good at. You would never do something that is so, that you're just bad at. And she said that her experience in being this rock climbing class really taught her something about understanding her English composition classes teaching. Because suddenly she's like, okay, for some people this is not easy and it will never be easy. And the reason I say this is a really kind of tragic story is she's also very famous for rewriting Wikipedia. She's part of the movement called Women Write Wikipedia of trying to insert more women's voices and women's entries into Wikipedia. So she's kind of made a name for herself very early on as an academic. She was doing a postdoc at Indiana, but then she actually had a rock climbing accident and died last year, two years ago actually. And it was a freak accident, so it wasn't like necessarily her fault, but you know, rock, boulder was loose. But I still like that story, right? I still like what she said, because her point wasn't, and if this story doesn't end and then she becomes a super famous rock climber. You know, in fact, ends quite tragically. But I think what Adrienne teaches us in that essay is that you have to have empathy for people who can never do it right. But the question is, but the other thing she conveyed so well in that essay is how much she loved it. So it didn't matter that she didn't do it well or could never learn to do it well, she just loved it. And so I think, you know, so I felt that perhaps is a different kind of way of thinking about the failure narrative rather than,
There's a beautiful physicality to that narrative too, which I loved your story, your Charles Schwab story of walking over the bridge that I feel like we haven't talked about in stories, about physicality and the embodiment of story, which is what that is.
Yeah. I think that something that struck me about that story too is the nature of success and our definitions of success, and I think that's fraught.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm.
And I think that what that story illustrates to me is that society kind of imposes a lot of these ideas of success on us and what is meant as success. But really, if you have to look at it and frame it that way, some people's success might be just participation, and that's fine.
And
the benefits are happiness. The benefits are manifold, and especially the benefits are manifold because you haven't allowed superficial definitions of success to be imposed upon you. You have taken responsibility and also had enough self-awareness to recognize your own limitations, and within those limitations have said success for me is this, and that in essence is empowering.
There's a big movement to include the stories of the conquered, because history is usually told in the voice of the conqueror. And yet, there's another story that's often not told. And so there's this huge press in children's literature now to tell those formerly untold stories.
And that connects back to what Mike was saying earlier, is like, through these stories, the kids are able to play, to jump into the perspectives of different characters, right? And be able, because every book, the protagonist we empathize with the protagonist because we see the full context of why they do what they do. I mean, Scarlett O'Hara in Gone with the Wind was a horrible person. Why are we rooting for her? Well, it's because she's a protagonist. But we know her motivations, right? And so to know, like now to see this wide swath of the same story but told from different perspectives, that's fantastic.
But yeah, I feel like it's interesting, this move in recent, there might have been many movements throughout history to reframe historical events, but it seems to me the main reason that the winners always tell the stories and tell them in the manner is because it usually, the stories arise from conflict, many times violent conflict, mm-hmm. conquest, and those are emotionally fraught by definition. Anytime you have that, when the winner wins, of course they're gonna be resentful and you know, they're gonna do everything they can to diminish, you know, for whatever reason, you know, with the result of that conflict. And it's interesting now, as we're hopefully evolving as a species, that we can kind of say with the length, with the distance and lack of emotion, no, we need to not only reframe those past stories, but now going forward in telling history, we need to be sensitive to that other dynamic, sensitive to our own emotional nature, and how can we extract emotion from the immediate retelling, or as immediate as possible? That's interesting to me.
And I would push that even one step further. I think that's absolutely right. I mean, that of course the conqueror tells the story, right? They also own the printing presses, so and the media. Recently there was a very smart article about that, you know, and the call for diversity in higher ed and literature representation. Mm-hmm. That's really the wrong word to use, diversity, right? It's kind of suggesting someone from the point on high saying, let's include some other little things. And they said, why don't we think of teaching it as calling it decolonized, right? Decolonization, oh, right? So cool. Really thinking about teaching stories from people who felt they didn't have voices before, right?
Yes.
So rather than saying, I'm just including your voice in my little, you know, multicultural week, but rather saying, no, you know, you have permission to tell your story. And so one of the things that we've done is, in one of my classes, is looking at superhero narratives for kids, mm-hmm. because one of the things, when you look at so many stories for middle-aged kids, like YA middle group kids, that heroes are white, right? Heroes are white male. It's about 6% mm-hmm. are not white or male or heterosexual. And the idea isn't that these stories don't have characters of color, right? But it's more that they don't have them as people with interiority. They're not mm-hmm. the main character with the flaws, with the kind of agonies, with the selfish impulses. And also, you know, and if they are, then they are in their own story, in their own segment, right? Mm-hmm. So it's about a black girl and her black family, like kind of thing. But rather than, you know, seeing Harry Potter, who is no questions asked a black woman, right? You know, mm-hmm. so I think Hermione being cast recently is very interesting. But, you know, this idea that, you know, you don't have to be representative. You don't have to represent your ethnicity or represent good. And so I think the idea of thinking decolonizing our stories is really a nice one, but just something to think about.
Yeah, I mean, storytelling, it's something that we can all learn how to be strategically better at, because it's for understanding our identity and for how we relate to each other. I mean, it's ever since the beginning when we have language, or even before we have language, the drawings on the walls and the caves, stories are part of our DNA. And so whether they're applied in a business context or whether in your personal context, or I see the periodic table storytelling,
yes.
They're from TV Tropes, I love that. They ultimately have impact. They have impact. So when you talk about Hamilton and the generativeness from that, or in fan fiction, that the Twilight series actually generated the 50 Shades of Grey, which, for the record, I have not read or seen the movie. this is being filmed. That's what I heard. there's a tremendous stories. I'm so excited about Story Lab because this is a place we can come to have these type of dialogues, to learn from one another, and to discover ourselves in the society that we live in.
Produced by Duke University, online at duke.edu.